JMP Audio, an imprint of John Murray Press, presents Thief, Prisoner, Soldier, Priest by Paul Cowley and Amanda Cowley. Read by Paul Cowley. My Foreword by Reverend Jonathan Aiken. Paul Cowley was born to serve. He started early by serving a prison sentence in Grizzly Risley, a notorious Lancashire jail for young offenders, which turned him off crime. Toughened by his dysfunctional and brutalised upbringing, he yearned for action. So his next move was to serve in Her Majesty's Armed Forces. He saw the world, and desperate for promotion, he served in Northern Ireland, the Falklands, Gibraltar, Cyprus and Germany. His military exploits and escapades make colourful reading. During the selection process, Paul turned down an opportunity to join the SAS. He stayed close enough to the Special Forces to be invited to become manager of the SAS Squash Club in London. It did not exist. What transpired was an opportunity to serve Mark Burley, the Mayfair club owner extraordinaire, who founded Annabelle's, Mark's Club, Harry's Bar and the Bath and Rackets Club. As manager of the Bath and Rackets Club, Paul moved in high society, serving many a health-conscious celebrity. Yet, curiously dissatisfied by his successful lifestyle, he was persuaded by a military colleague to start searching for God. He attended various churches until landing at Holy Trinity Brompton in Knightsbridge. As his messy personal life consisted more of sinning than serving, former Sergeant Cowley did not look like a good potential HDB recruit. But God moves in mysterious ways. I entered Paul's life in a small way some 20 years ago. I accompanied him to HMP Dartmoor and other prisons when he was leading and developing Alpha courses. He was further down the road on his spiritual journey than I was. But as ex-cons who were doing a bit of public speaking, we bonded over our shared passion for prison ministry and became close friends. The chapters in this book that strike the deepest chords for me are those which describe Paul's inner journey to a new Christ-centered life of service as an ordained priest, prison chaplain, pioneer of Alpha prisons, and founder of Alpha forces and caring for ex-offenders. He is also the bishop's advisor to prisons and the ambassador for social transformation at HTB and Alpha International. The cast of characters in this part of the Paul Cowley story are even more extraordinary than those he met on the wilder shores of his youth. Some of them I know well, such as Bishop Sandy Miller, Nicky Gumbel, Jack Cowley, Bishop Graham Tomlin, Emmy Wilson, and the true heroine of the book, Paul's wife and co-author Amanda. All have played pivotal roles in the unfolding tapestry of Paul's transformative and still growing life of service. They would all agree that both the story and the service is remarkable. But what is this book really about at its deepest level? Paul Cowley is only its narrator. The story is about a man's redemption. Unconditional love changed the direction of Paul's life from self-service to God's service. The self-service chapters of part one make for a fast-moving and compelling read. But why was Paul left unsatisfied by its worldly excitements and successes? The answer, as made clear in part two, is because he had an unexpected call to a higher level of service and vocation. Acknowledgements. I frequently ask myself the question, how does a man born into a dysfunctional family with very little formal education and subsequently a criminal record become a priest in the Church of England? On some days I am truly perplexed, but have come to realise it is the love of God and the help of some wonderful family, friends and work colleagues. A huge thank you to my wife, Amanda, for her unceasing dedication to write my story, which hasn't always been an easy journey for either of us. I salute you. To my son, Clinton, for having the grace to forgive me. To my daughter, Phoebe, for teaching me how to be a father. A special thank you to Anna, who has shown me love over the years, and who took care of my father when I couldn't, to Amanda's mum, Tricia, for her editing skills, and to her and her husband, Andrew, for their love and support over the last few decades. Thanks also to my wife's brother, James, and the Willison family, who have become my own. With particular thanks to Eric Martin, who set me on a course of searching for God and for his continued companionship, and to Nick and Debs Henderson, who, in friendship, challenged my behaviour on several occasions. Friends who have loved and supported Amanda and me over the years include Christina Page, Lisa Ashton, Amanda Tucker, Bishop Rick and Louis Thorpe, the Reverend Andy and Sue Keithley, Martin and Catherine Bennett, Nick and Jane Ungen, Nick and Annie Chance, Tan and David Buxton, Olga and Nicholas Galandris, Justin and Anna Walford, Dan and Susan Haig, the Reverend Simon and Sue Kirby. Huge thanks to Reverend Jonathan Aiken, who has been a mentor and dear friend, sitting with Amanda and me over the past 2 years, advising us on the content and style of the book. Fortunately, Jonathan and I are able to rejoice together at how God has changed us for the better. Also, a big thanks to my publisher, Hodder and Stoughton, to Andy Lyon, Jessica Lacey, and the whole team, who had a strong conviction to publish this story. To Mark Elson-Jew, who believed in the story and helped us connect with Hodder, and to Amanda Elson-Jew for some early editing. The Most Reverend Justin Welby, who has encouraged me personally, but also by his example, with his passion for the lost, lonely, and marginalised. I am also forever grateful to Bishop Sandy Miller, who has been like a father to me, chastising me and encouraging me in equal measure, and to Annette for copious amounts of tea and friendly reassurance, to Bishop Graham Tomlin for his unceasing enthusiasm for prison ministry and for appointing me as Bishop's advisor to prisons. Thanks to the Reverend Nicky Gumbel and his wife Pippa, who have supported and encouraged me in my vision for numerous social transformation projects at Holy Trinity Brompton. Thanks also to the Reverend Emmy Wilson, who is like a sister to me, and without whom I may have never embarked on prison work. I am indebted to her for being so prayerful and obedient in her belief that God had a call on my life. To work colleagues, including my line manager and friend Tricia Neal, the Reverend Nikki Lee, my prayer partner, and his wife Scylla, both having counselled Amanda and me on many occasions, especially in raising our daughter. Will van der Hart, a sensitive man with the heart of a lion, and a wonderful ministry to those with mental health issues. Andrea Graham, my excellent EA. Also thanks to members of the ministry team at Holy Trinity Brompton, who have spurred me on. And to Steve Page, Reverend Bill and Claire Birdwood, and Reverend Matt Boyce. The Reverend Tom Johns, a truly kind and gentle man, who I first met when he was one of the 4 assistant chaplain generals to the prison system. His love and belief in me were extraordinary. The Reverend Ann Coleman, my tutor at Theological College, without whose encouragement and listening ear I would never have completed my first year of training. Thanks to my friends and work colleagues over the pond, Jack Cowley, Alpha Prisons, USA, a friend and mentor in the prison work, John Mackay and Mike Timmis for their friendship and for being instrumental in the prison ministry in the USA since it was formed. Daughter and Truett Tate for their hospitality and sense of fun, James Ackerman, the president and CEO of Prison Fellowship, who was eager to include Alpha Prisons, Jim Liskey, chair of the board of Crossroads Prison Ministries, for his friendship and pastoral support. Thanks also to Melinda Dwight and John O'Green in Australia, who adopted the William Wilberforce Foundation and really embraced working with the marginalised. A big thank you to others who have encouraged me in my work, including Prince Michael of Kent, Simon Rufus Isaacs, the 4th Marquess of Reading, Lord Michael Hastings, Sir Paul Boateng, Dame Philippa Stroud, Lord David Ramsbottom, Major General Tim Cross, CBE, Lady Williams of Elville, Peter Welby, and Lady Jane Williams and the Right Honourable Rory Stewart, MP. Thanks also go to the amazing men and women who work in the chaplaincy departments of our prisons and our military bases around the UK. Working in some of the hardest environments, they bring light into dark places, often lonely in their quest to help change people's lives. I'm constantly humbled by their dedication and passion. Having witnessed the power of the Holy Spirit truly transform their lives, I wish to thank a few inspiring reformed characters: Michael, Brian, Finney, Sean, Eddie, John, Dave, Shane, Graham, Ross, and Darren. Prologue. We can make our plans, but the Lord determines our steps. Proverbs 16, verse 9. Mine is a story of a man who eventually succumbed to God knocking on his door. When I first met with God, it was a bit of a shock, possibly for both of us, because I didn't think God bothered with people like me. I was stubborn and opinionated and certainly self-sufficient. The purpose of this story is to give people hope. It is not the tale of a gangster or a violent man. I didn't do a life sentence or commit a horrendous crime, and I wasn't a military hero. In that respect, it is not a dramatic story. But for that very reason, there may be many readers who can identify with my experiences, especially from my early years. The word sin may seem old-fashioned, but one definition is to miss the mark. And that's what I did. Much of my early life is embarrassing and makes me feel ashamed. Some of the stories may be difficult to read, but it is the truth as I remember it. I have therefore changed some people's names in order to give them some privacy. A good friend of mine who works for a charity dealing with dysfunctional kids from inner city estates told me how on a train heading out to the country, one teenage girl in the group was staring out of the window. Asked if she was okay, she turned to him and responded, "I didn't know my eyes could see this far." Without hope and vision, our faces, our attitudes, and our self-esteem start to turn downwards, when really they should be looking upwards towards new horizons. So when your mum reinforces a negative stereotype of your dad, screaming at him that a Cowley man will never achieve anything, and the only thing they are good at is drinking, fighting, womanizing, and being in debt, as a child you believe you are no better. And when your father belittles your mother and spends his time chasing women and drinking, then you assume that's what men do. Words are powerful, given and received at any age. And what I've come to understand is if teachers, parents, peers, friends, or family speak negatively into our lives, then those words can stick. Seeds of self-doubt start to take root and grow, making us believe we are nothing more than useless, slowly knocking out any hope we might have had. I have learned that this type of upbringing has a profound effect on your brain, as a single word has the power to influence the expression of genes that regulate physical and emotional stress. In the first half of my life, my parents and their friends furnished me with a mindset that justified the direction my life was taking. If you are not careful, it can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. I wasn't careful. The words and scripture spoken and revealed to me in the second part of my life, after my conversion, made the hairs on my arms stand up and brought a tear to my eye. They were powerful, dynamic, poetic, inspiring, romantic, and challenging. But mostly, they were encouraging. This is the story of my fall and my redemption, my journey of discovery, and an insight into how I got the help I needed when I missed the mark. In the words of John O'Donohue, You can suffer from a desperate hunger to be loved. You can search long years in lonely places, far outside yourself. Yet the whole time, this love is but a few inches away from you. It is at the edge of your soul, but you have been blind to its presence. We must remain attentive in order to be able to receive it. I therefore encourage you, whatever your start in life, or whatever troubles you are facing today, to remain attentive. Take a real hard look at yourself and ask the question, is my plan the only way, or could God be offering me something better? If, like me, you have fallen down in the first half of your life, you have a chance to get up in the second half. You can, with the help of God and a loving, supportive group of people, be literally reshaped and transformed by the renewing of your mind. Romans 12, verse 2. It is such an exciting journey. Trust me, I'm still on it. Part 1. The first half of my life. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. 1. Life started with a bang. I don't doubt that my dad loved me, although I am unable to feel or remember much love from him. He was a larger-than-life character with a Liverpudlian accent and a charismatic charm, disguising his darker and more forceful side. Arthur Cowley had a difficult upbringing, and it is therefore not surprising that he struggled with communication. His father had been a bare-knuckle street fighter in Toxteth, Liverpool, and by all accounts was very successful, supporting his ever-growing family. His mother, Florence, a large woman, over 6 foot, with jet black hair, had a huge drink problem and was apparently quite promiscuous. His parents' relationship was volatile. And in 1931, when my dad was 5 years old, the neighbours complained to the authorities that the three Cowley children were left too long on their own. His parents were taken to court by child welfare services, and when the judge asked them who would take care of their son, in turn they replied, "I don't want him." The judge said he would have to go to a care home for boys. His mother whispered into his ear, "It will be the best thing for you." My dad went straight from that courtroom to a home in the Dingle area along the Liverpool coastline, and only when he was in his 70s did he tell me about it. My mother was right. It was the best thing to happen to me. I was well fed and clothed, taught skills such as woodwork and calligraphy, as well as doing some basic cooking and cleaning. I asked him if he had missed his mum and dad. There wasn't much to miss. At the home, I was taught to sew up hems of trousers and darn socks and thread beads. When I teased him, he replied, "I loved threading beads for the women who took care of me. It made me popular." Leaving the home at 14, he was sent to Shenton's farm in Cheadle for 3 years. The work was hard. Up at 4 a.m, out milking cows and collecting eggs. Then back in at 7:30 for breakfast, porridge and a cup of tea. And then out again, for ploughing or reaping. The farmer often beat me. When I asked why, he said, "I never knew. Just took a stick to me with any excuse. But it made a man of me. I grew to be a big, strong teenager." They should send more kids there instead of letting them roam the streets. Many years later, he went back and knocked on the farmer's door. Apparently, the farmer took one look at him and said, "Crumbs, you turned out to be big." "Do you want to beat me now?" said Arthur. He could have borne a grudge, but he chose not to. He shook hands with the farmer, and always referred to the time he spent on the farm as good. In my early days, my dad played a huge role in my life. And ironically, he continues to be a big part of my life today, even though he died many years ago. My entry into the world started with a bang. Late on Bonfire Night, 5th of November 1955. When returning from the pub, some kids threw a firecracker that landed at my mum's feet, scaring her enough that her waters broke. Arthur drove like a madman to Crumsall Hospital, and I was born in the early hours of the 7th. Delivered by the nuns from the St. Paul's Order, from which my name was secured. My mum, Brenda Saxon, was an attractive woman with piercing blue eyes, high cheekbones, and a winning smile. She was 30 years old when she met Arthur on a ferry crossing the Mersey on the way to the Isle of Man. He was 2 years younger, 6'2", muscular and tanned, with huge hands. A good-looking man, who on entering a room immediately became the focus of attention. Arthur and Brenda were both excited when they realised they would be working together for the whole summer at Housedrake Holiday Camp, a sort of early Butlins on the cliff face of the island near Douglas. There followed a whirlwind romance and I was conceived. On returning to Liverpool, Arthur wasn't expecting Brenda to say, "I'm married to a man who beats me. He will kill me when he finds out about us." Arthur took matters into his own hands. Turning up at Brenda's home, he beat the living daylights out of her husband. Leaving her two children, she moved in with Arthur. Their first home was on Great Jackson Street, Manchester. Rows and rows of terraced houses with entrances at the back, like you might see on Coronation Street. Basic houses with no frills. Two up, two down, with an outside toilet in the yard, often filled with a washing line and large white bed sheets flapping in the wind. Arthur also had a family, of which I know little, except that he had a son, about 5 years older than me. I met him briefly when I was around 10. Dad brought him to the house, but due to him being rude and bullish towards me, my mum said, "He needs to go." Dad took him by the arm, and they left. My parents both had a series of jobs, but most of the money they made went on drink and my dad's passion for cars. When I was 5 years old, he bought a Ford Popular, and when I was 8, a Morris Minor Traveller. At 10, a Ford Zodiac. It was one of his proudest moments when he drove his new MG Magnet Mark IV out of a car showroom in Wimslow. Unsurprisingly, his pride in cars rubbed off on me. I believe my dad's care for me was evident, but in some ways it was inept, and this came up time and time again. One of my earliest memories, aged 5, was going to Manchester Royal Infirmary to see a specialist about a squint in my right eye. My parents were told that I needed an operation in order to correct it. In the car park, Dad said to Mum, "No son of mine is having an eye operation." I was taken back to the doctor, who gave me a patch for my left eye to make my right eye work harder. I still have a lazy eye to this day. Another time when I was 8 years old, he took me to Gorton Park and sat me on a high wall. It was a game of trust and dare. Crouching on the wall, I took a small jump, and he caught me and swung me around. Confidently, I stood on the wall and dived into his arms again. As he moved further and further away, the jumps became longer and riskier, until the time I leapt into the air. He stepped to the side, and I fell to the ground. I was shocked, hurt, and embarrassed, thinking it was my fault. On the way home, we didn't speak, but I was used to that. Mum cleaned the grazes on my hands and knees with Dettol and sent me upstairs. She proceeded to yell at him. The house was small, and so I could hear them clearly. "What the hell were you thinking, Arthur?" she said. Dad shouted back, "I was teaching him a lesson. Not to trust anyone, because they will always move away from him or disappoint him." Mum, screaming at the top of her voice, replied, "Teach him a lesson. All you're doing is teaching him to hate you." But Dad was right about the impression his lesson had left me with. Unfortunately, it was a lesson that stayed with me for too many years. I also remember a time when I was 11. I returned home from school one afternoon to find a party in the front room, with my dad serving drinks from the bar in the corner. I asked a stranger what the party was for, and she told me, "Their wedding, of course." I had no idea they weren't married. It was a subject they never raised with me, and I didn't feel I could talk to them about it. Unlike my parents, I didn't experience World War II, but a flat jacket and a tin helmet might have given me some protection from my parents' crossfire. They smoked a lot, drank a lot, and swore a lot. Their dramas had a cyclical pattern, and as a child, I absorbed it without question. It began on Friday nights around 6 p.m. as I walked with my parents to the local working men's club. Once inside, Dad picked a table and we became entrenched for the next 3 or more hours. Monty, our huge German shepherd, sat quietly by my side, while Dad and Mum played the slot machines, pints of Guinness and glasses of rum and blackcurrant stacked up on small round tables. Ashtrays overflowed until closing time. Saturday was a repeat of Friday, and then on Sunday, Mum spent an age preparing lunch, to be eaten on trays in the front room, often watching a World War II movie. After lunch, it was as if a bell had been struck to announce the beginning of round one. Ding ding! Dad, wanting to get to the pub, always started an argument. An excuse to leave, slam the door, and find solace among friendships that never went deeper than commiserations and crude jokes. When he rolled in late and very drunk, Mum wouldn't speak to him for the next 36 hours. By Tuesday morning, he was remorseful enough to cuddle her and apologise by making tea and toast. For the next 2 days, they would even be a little romantic. On Friday at 6 p.m, we went back to the club to start the weekly routine. Their arguments frightened me because they were so cruel to each other. It wasn't just the abuse, but the volume at which they shouted, screaming and belittling one another. There was always a chance that my mother would push my dad too far. Always the fear that he would overreact. As a young boy, my favourite place in the world was the Isle of Man. We went there regularly to stay at Housedrake, where my parents had met. I felt connected to the island and the people. The locals always commented favourably on my Viking complexion, blonde hair and blue eyes. It was many years later that I discovered that our surname, Cowley, originally derived not from the cow pastures of England, but from Macaulay, the shortened form of Mac Oliev, Anlaf's or Olaf's son. In the 9th century, the North Sea King, Olaf the White, having reached Ireland with a large fleet, then migrated to the Isle of Man, and the adapted Cowley name was everywhere. I often spent the summer weeks with Dad's mum, Florence Cowley. Nana Flory loved me and gave me special attention, maybe because she had abandoned my dad when he was young and wanted to compensate by spoiling me. I loved her simply because she made me laugh when I sat next to her in the buttery at Housedrake where she worked. She had an air of importance about her as she was in charge of around 30 women, which meant they all respected her and spoilt me. In 1960, when I was 5, Dad got a new job as a security officer for Bellevue, the largest amusement centre in England. And so we moved into a rundown flat opposite the main gate on Hyde Road. Bellevue was set in 165 acres of land, with a large zoo, amusement park, exhibition hall complex, speedway, and greyhound racing stadiums. With more than 2 million visitors a year, it soon became one of the North's most popular attractions. A year later, Dad was promoted to Chief Security Officer and could afford a two-bedroomed house in Rosemary Street in Gorton. I liked living in Rosemary Street because it had a sense of community. with a corner shop, a butcher's and a grocery shop. There was a short time in my life when I played in the streets with a ball and I made a few friends. Gorton Park was nearby, and there were often gatherings throughout the year, including Christmas and Easter parades and Palm Sunday events, and I remember being fascinated by the spectacle of them. At Bellevue, I was so proud of Dad, dressed in his dark blue uniform, an Alsatian guard dog at his side. I'd like nothing better than to accompany him on his patrol around the site as he received a great deal of attention, especially from women. At other times, he left me watching the circus or wrestling or holding the hand of one of his many female admirers while he carried out his duties. One morning, coming downstairs, I saw two men standing in the front room arguing with my mum. They removed the television and some other things from the house. My dad came home that night and was furious, stomping around and shouting at my mum for letting the bailiffs take his stuff, which was a regular occurrence, and we often had to wait a few weeks for Dad to get paid before getting our belongings back. My dad, however, was my hero because he was big and strong and never appeared to be scared of anything. He acquired guard dogs, mainly Alsatians, by retrieving them from building sites. Once I saw him take hold of a raging Alsatian that had been left on the end of a rope in a scrapyard. As it bit into his hand, he held it tightly round the neck until it became subdued. He then brought it home and rehabilitated it. After that incident, he became a bit of a legend in the neighbourhood, and for me it became a powerful memory that I have relayed time and time again when working with men coming out of prison. Unfortunately, a series of events occurred over the next few years which would change the opinion I had of my dad. After the incident on the wall, Mum discovered that Dad was carrying on with several women he had met at Bellevue. His drinking was increasing, along with the lies. Driving back after a drinking session at the Conservative Club one afternoon in his Ford Popular, he took a shortcut home. I was sitting in the back while Mum was in the front passenger seat shouting abuse at him. Dad's hands were firmly fixed to the wheel. "Quiet!" he shouted. Suddenly he reached over, opened the passenger door and pushed her out. I screamed, "Mum!" But he didn't care. He closed the door and carried on driving. I remember looking out of the back window and seeing her lying on the pavement, being helped up by a young woman who had witnessed the event. At home, my mother became withdrawn. I knew she was shocked because I felt it deep down too. She was never really the same after that. Mum was not an easy woman to live with. She wound Dad up, but she didn't deserve his cruelty and indifference. Sometimes I would find her in a darkened room listening to Patsy Cline's Three Cigarettes and an Ashtray on the record player, waiting for my father to appear, expecting some excuse. I've learned that indifference can kill a relationship even more than hate. It weakens someone's spirit deep within and changes them. When I was 10 years old, we moved to my parents' first business, a sweet and tobacconist shop on the corner of Donison Street. Attached to the shop at the back was a large yard where my dad built a carport with a fence around it and a corrugated roof to protect his brand new MG Magnet Mark IV. Having left Bellevue, he was working late shifts as a security guard for British Road Services, an enormous warehouse based in Manchester, a distribution centre for mail order products. The Cowley household seemed to acquire an enormous amount of new stuff, electrical goods, clothing and more. Mum, meanwhile, was running the shop, but it wasn't going well due to her rudeness and impatience with customers, mostly neighbours who ran up debts. Opposite our house was a dry cleaning shop, run by a tough Irish family with three huge adult brothers whom my dad hated, due to an ongoing feud that was started by my mum in the shop. One Saturday afternoon when Dad returned home from the pub, he parked the car on the road outside the house. Unbeknown to us, he had thrown a house brick through the large glass window of the dry cleaners. A few hours later, he left the house to go back to the pub, but within minutes stormed back in, shouting, "Brenda, have you seen the state of my car?" Mum and I ran out to take a look. Paint stripper had been poured over the bonnet, and paint was peeling off down to the metal. I remember my father's face. He looked menacing. "They won't get away with it. I'll show them," he said. What unnerved me most was how he sat down and did nothing, because his normal reaction would have been to act immediately. Over the years, I had experienced him bursting into fits of rage in pubs and working men's clubs, or on the street, thumping someone for staring at Mum, or for giving him a disapproving look. He was being unusually passive, and it wasn't what I expected. I now know that it was weighing up the situation, and like a curled snake was waiting for the opportunity to strike. The brothers had their own idea. That evening, when I was in the bath, I heard one of the men shouting, "Come out, Cowley, you coward!" The front door slammed. There was to be no talking, no negotiating. Still dripping from the bath, a towel held around my waist, I arrived on the doorstep to see a man lying on the pavement, holding his head, blood splattered on the ground. Dad's hand was around the neck of another man. He lifted him off the pavement, pressed him against the wall of the house, and punched him in the face repeatedly. The third brother ran up the street. It was never a good idea to call my dad a coward. Mum, grabbing my arm, removed me from the carnage, but the shock of seeing Dad's brutality at such close range made me throw up on the stairs. At that moment, I knew the brothers were bad, but realised my father was far worse. I'm not sure how, but in 1966 I passed my 11 plus and was to go to Manchester Grammar School. I was excited when I visited the school and saw its vast playing fields. But my parents moved yet again to a small bungalow in Wimmo Lane in Denton, and I was sent to Edgerton Park, secondly modern. There was no discussion on the matter, but I remember being quite devastated. I can only think that the journey to the grammar school was awkward for them, while Edgerton Park was a mile away from our house. My parents never valued education, so they didn't understand how going to a grammar school could have helped me in my life. My mother, meanwhile, became one of the first traffic wardens in the area and very quickly gained a reputation for giving out the most tickets. Edgerton Park was enormous, with a bad reputation. At 12 years old, I was a small-framed kid with blue eyes and wavy blonde hair. Dad nicknamed me Blue, after Billy Blue Cannon in the High Chaparral. I think he fancied himself as Big John Cannon, the Arizonian rancher, played by Leif Erikson, a striking and manly actor, typical of the John Wayne era. Mum loved to make a feature of my hair, brushing it over and over, but once I got to school, I would run to the sink, wet a comb and flatten it down before the dreaded school day began. As it dried, it bounced upwards, becoming the focal point for the school bullies who thumped and kicked me in the playground at break time. What made things worse was that my surname incurred nicknames including Cowpat and Cowshit, which echoed around the playground every day. I went from one explosion at home, Mum hitting me around the head whenever I disagreed with her, to another at school, where some kid wanted to show off by bullying me at the gate or in the playground. Unfortunately, I also had a speech impediment, often mixing up my L's and my R's. Liverpool became Riverpool, and River became River. The drama teacher gave me some elocution lessons, but even today I can mix up some letters. Added to this, I was blighted by frequent cold sores, my lips often covered in red, crusty blisters, and I was totally uncoordinated. This meant I was the last to get picked for a team on sports day, the two team captains arguing over who had to take Cowley. Lastly, I had my lazy right eye, which when I got stressed or tired moved over to the far corner and must have made me look strange. I dreaded the name-calling, the punching and the bullying. I wanted to melt into the wooden seat in my classroom to avoid the bell, which would mean facing the bullies in the corridor. The bell also indicated the end of the school day, when they would get me as I walked home. I simply hated school and cannot recall having even one friend. I often woke in the night in a sweat from recurring nightmares, fueled by the events of the day or from watching war films with my dad late into the night. Most days I return home from school in tears, and my father, annoyed at my weakness, would say, "If you can't hit 'em, kick 'em. If you can't kick 'em, get a big stick." By the age of 14, I decided to take his advice and put an end to the bullying. So I agreed to accept the offer of a fight on the sports field near our home. I imagined I would be triumphant, like the heroes in the spaghetti westerns I watched with my dad, and that the worst bully would leave me alone for good. But unfortunately, he beat the living daylights out of me, and I was left in the mud, watched by a large crowd of my peers that had gathered. Not my finest hour. I started to resent my father because he wouldn't teach me to fight, and I felt vulnerable for years. But perhaps he wanted a different life for me. Just maybe he didn't want me to turn out like him. Meanwhile, my studies at school were suffering and I started truanting to avoid any more confrontations with bullies and teachers. Everything started to go downhill, and Edgerton Park could not prepare me for what was to happen next. 2. Never come to anything. By the time I was 16, life at home had deteriorated. Mum was preparing the Sunday roast when an almighty row broke out yet again, and my father raised his hand to strike her. Dashing to defend her, I felt the full force of his hand across my face, and I was knocked over. It was the first time my dad had ever hit me. Mum had slapped me across the head many times, but not my dad. He told me to get out and don't come back. So I threw some clothes in a bag and walked out of the house. 50 meters later, I stopped and realized what I'd done. I had no plan, no money, and no hope. All I knew was that I had to escape the war zone. It had to be better out of the house than in it. After my dad backhanded me, he came crashing down off the pedestal I had placed him on. I not only lost respect for him, but the powerful giant of a man that I had adored as a very young boy never quite shined for me again. You might wonder how my mother got over the car incident when I was 8 years old. I think in many ways it put my parents' relationship under huge pressure. But time heals, or so they say. Or maybe it was Dad's hemorrhoids. They were so bad that he had to have an urgent operation. The doctor advised him to take a long rest. So he went on his own for 2 weeks to Tarragona on the Spanish coast. To Mum's annoyance, she had to remain working in the shop. Returning with a deep suntan, he presented Mum with a huge box. And when she opened it, she laughed out loud. "What the hell is it?" "What do you mean? It's bloody obvious what it is. It's a bull's head," he said. It was menacing and as black as coal, made of papier-mâché and mounted on a wooden plinth. He didn't care what she thought. He loved it. I was presented with a gift of 2 shiny bullfighting swords wrapped in newspaper. "Wow, Dad, they're brilliant. Can I use them?" "No, son, too dangerous. Give them here." Taking the 2 swords, he attached them to either side of the bull's head on the wooden plinth and mounted it over the fireplace. As we watched television that evening, the bull glared down at the 3 of us, its horns spanning the chimney stack. Such a fixture provoked laughter from friends that popped in to have a drink. But Mum defended Dad. "I think the bull is strong and courageous like Arthur," she said, caressing its nose as she passed by. But when the arguments restarted, I imagine the swords being drawn from the wall and a battle taking place in the living room. When Dad painted La Casita onto a plaque and put it at the side of the front door, Mum said, "Arthur, what does that mean?" He said, "It means small house, woman. Don't you know anything? My casa is su casa. My house is your house." Mum decided we all needed to go to Spain and immediately booked our summer holiday. I loved time with my dad. The two of us preparing the MG magnet for the long drive, pouring oil into a smaller can for the trip and stashing bottles of water for the windscreen, as well as hiding a plentiful supply of rags and tools in every spare nook and cranny. Meanwhile, Mum bought biscuits and bottles of orange squash, magazines and a new pair of fashionable sunglasses that shrouded her small features. The night before our departure, she made Spam sandwiches, placing them in a Tupperware box in the fridge, ready for the journey at the crack of dawn. At 5 a.m. we left the house, driving off on the epic trip from the dark, damp streets of Manchester to Dover, taking a Townsend Thoreson car ferry across the channel to Calais. As we drove down through the centre of France, heading for Tarragona near Barcelona, I lay on the back seat for hours with no restriction or safety from a seatbelt. When it turned dark, I was lulled to sleep by watching light from the street lamps pass over the car. From the moment we left Manchester, the burden of cohabiting evaporated. Holidays were my parents' happiest times together, as passion was relit and their marriage was safe for a time. Once they had checked into the Hotel Marina, a 3-star establishment on the coast, Dad immediately unpacked the car. He changed into his trunks and walked over the road to the beach, hiring 2 sunbeds for himself and Mum, and then plonking himself down with an ice-cold San Miguel. His deep sigh of relief was a sound that Mum and I really loved, because we knew he was happy at that moment. The beach was so hot, we had to walk on the mats provided, my dad insisting we play the game of seeing who could stand on the sand the longest. Of course, he always won. One evening, we were all sitting outside at the hotel bar when a stray dog, which Dad had grown fond of, came timorously looking for food. A Spaniard drinking his beer kicked the dog and it yelped. Within a split second, Dad backhanded the man off his bar stool and walked calmly back to the table, muttering, "Bloody peasant, that's no way to treat a dog." A small Spanish man was no match for my dad, and no one ever dared to challenge him. Mum sat quietly smoking and drinking her rum and coke, used to his dramas. Dad would have rescued all the stray dogs in the vicinity if he had had somewhere to take them. Bullfighting appealed to Dad's masculinity and he insisted on going back each year. However, he battled with respecting an age-old tradition versus the pointless act of cruelty to a living beast. When the bull was finally defeated with the matador driving his sword into its heart, he had to turn away. The heat and the smell of death made me feel nauseous. But Mum refused to take me out, and we all sat there until the spectacle was over. Dad found some solace in the rumour that the meat from the bull was given to the poor. It was the beginning of the Spanish-themed bungalow in Windmill Lane. Dad bought wallpaper with a recurring print of a matador holding a red cloak, posing over a bull in mid-charge. Mum didn't want it, but gave up arguing as she realised how determined he was. He decorated the front room with me by his side, mixing the powdered wallpaper glue in a saucepan with the handle of a wooden spoon. When it was finished, he called Mum in. She was speechless, but Dad and I were chuffed with the result. Constructing a bar in the corner of the living room, he suspended optics of every type of spirit, and beer mats from the local pub were strewn upon the surfaces. We lived our lives in a parallel universe with our own language, a form of Spanglish being spoken in the twilight hours, Dad turning on the charm. "Hola, Brenda. You Bueno? Mum replying, I'm Bueno, Arthur. Gracias. Dad holding up a bottle of Bacardi and pouring in some Coke. Una Cuba Libre, por favor? Si, said Mum. Get me a shot too while you're up there, Arthur. All of us watching TV in a cloud of smoke as they puffed away together. Dad eventually rising from the smog. Right, Brenda, let's go to the pub. I always went with them, except on rare occasions, such as when the moon landing was televised in 1969. I sat on my own in the kitchen watching it on a tiny black and white portable TV. The spectacle of it gave me a sense of belonging. 50 years later, I had the same feeling when I watched a BBC documentary commemorating the event. It occurred to me that during this moment in history, when 500 million people were in awe of this remarkable achievement, my parents were in the pub. Most of my childhood memories begin and end in smoke-filled pubs, listening to adult stories and jokes, hundreds of them, made at the expense of some race, be it Irish, Scottish, or African. Dad cried with laughter. His joviality was infectious. Soon everyone had tears rolling down their faces and bellies that ached for days. I didn't understand the jokes, but I got the fun of them, although now I understand they were all highly offensive. In the 60s and 70s, there was little awareness about the language of prejudice. Jokes were, in some way, a break from the anger and the daily grind of life. Unfortunately, the daily grind permeated my world like the nicotine-stained walls and ceiling tiles of our home. In 1970, I was 15 years old and still at Edgerton Park Secondary Modern. It had never occurred to my parents to remove me from the continual bullying by placing me in another school. Fundamentally, I think they were just too self-absorbed with their own dramas to take mine seriously. However, the teachers were noticing my bad attitude and my regular truancy. Paul is a waste of time, said the maths teacher. He will never come to anything, echoed another. I don't ever remember my parents attending a parents' evening, so I was able to keep my shortcomings to myself for a while, but not for very long. At that time, two things happened to me that shaped my life. First, I was expelled from school, mostly because of truancy. I left with no qualifications except for a 25-yard swimming certificate. Since my parents were not academic, they didn't seem too upset about me being expelled. They were just happy that a good friend of theirs, a policeman, had taken me through my life-saving proficiency awards, but I was relieved I didn't have to go into school every day. Second, I got caught up in the middle of my parents arguing over Dad's womanizing. I shouted for them to stop, but they wouldn't. I could bear it no longer. I went to the nearest wall and started banging my head against it. Stop it, please, stop it, I shouted. It had the desired effect. Mum grabbed me and held me in her arms. Even now I can remember that moment. The intimacy, the softness and the smell of her. There was peace for a while, but it wasn't to last for long. My father soon secured a job as a caretaker for a block of flats, and so we moved yet again to a small terrace house in Didsbury. And the bull's head and swords came with us. Mum insisted that I start contributing to the household finances, which meant I took the first job available, an apprenticeship in Pollard's family butchers. An apprenticeship appealed to me, as I wanted to learn a trade. I was hired immediately by the two brothers and they put me to work. I started at the bottom, sweeping the floor, making the tea, and mincing all the scraps of meat, lungs and offal, to be sold as dog meat. Playing numerous pranks, the brothers crept up behind me and dropped large steel trays, which made me jump, and they were frequently locking me in the walk-in freezer. The meagre wage of £5 for the first week's work did not entice me to stay, and I never went back. In the space of 12 months, I had many jobs, including working in a freezer centre in Stockport and being an assistant in a camping equipment store, a salesman for Corona Soft Drinks Company, and a plumber's mate. It seemed I was following in my dad's footsteps as he continued to go from job to job. After working as a security officer at BRS, he then went self-employed, starting his own company, a security firm using security officers, friends from the pub, and Alsatians he had rescued and trained. Having found some of his letter-headed paper years later, I discovered it was called Argus Guard Dogs, named after Odysseus's faithful dog in Homer's epic Greek poem, The Odyssey. My father's capacity to love dogs was extraordinary, and I think it possibly happened because he found the relationship more straightforward than dealing with people who challenged him. Studying in the evenings, he then went on to fulfill a lifelong dream of becoming a private detective. He took on many divorce cases, following people and taking photos of them in compromising situations. I think he fancied himself as Dick Tracy. I subsequently became a driver's mate working for Express Dairies, a large milk company based in Stockport. After a few weeks in the job, I realised that some of the drivers had ways of making extra cash. Once I was trusted to say nothing, I became involved in their scam.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.